around 95, 96 when they first started coming into their own as a local band in places like this. You know, this is now Harry Mary's. It's still a rock club. Back then it was known as the Safari Club, and it was changing from kind of reggae music into a more progressive rock and metal shed. Some of their first Slipknot's first shows were band battles.
Two battle of the bands that determine who was going to play on the main stage for Dot Fest. And the first one, Slipknot, won that one.
And so that's how Slipknot really gained some credibility early on, was by winning those and by being consistent from week to week too.
And the second one, never forget this show because this is just really cool. It was at what's now Harry Mary's, used to be called Safari then. The finals was us and Stone Sour, and we narrowly beat out Stone Sour by like 30 points, I think it was. It's like one of the closest contests of all the battles, and got our slot on Dot Fest along with Slipknot, so that was pretty cool.
I couldn't figure out how they were ever going to tour, because seven people and equipment is too much for one band. It's too expensive to put seven people up in a hotel, and if you have road crew, which they had road crew and they didn't even play outside of Des Moines. You know, they had people running around and moving their equipment for them. I just could never figure out how there was ever going to be enough money to pay them to do what they do.
Industry people are concerned about the practicalities, but Slipknot are only concerned with perfecting the lineup. Anders' voice isn't good enough. It has to be Corey Taylor from Stone Sour.
Paul, I think, or Joey, one of the two. But mainly Mick, they just went up to him and said, "You're going to join us, we're going to kick your ass." And he's like, "All right."
Anders probably wasn't as good a singer as Corey. The fact that he was willing to cut himself on stage, you know, was pretty bizarre.
The first industry person to get behind Slipknot is Sophia John, the program director at Dot FM, one of the local alternative radio stations.
She worked for a radio station. She believed in them, and she got behind them and used some of her connections and, you know, helped the right people hear them. She didn't help them become who they are, just helped the right people in the industry see who they were.
If you don't like it, we really don't care because we're in charge.
Back in the day, it was Slipknot and Stone Sour were the two big heavies in Des Moines. And I think Slipknot had always prevailed as far as bands go. And then they had recruited Corey, and Stone Sour broke up. And then the next year, the three big bands were Slipknot, now with Corey, and 35 Inch Mutter, and then Smack Dab.
You know, there had been some feuding going on, you know, with those guys and another band. It was one radio station supported Slipknot, and another radio station supported the other band.
Corey Brown was the lead singer for 35 Inch Mutter. And he was, at the time, working, well, I guess he still is, working at Laser 103.3. And Slipknot's manager was Sophia John, who had worked at 107.5, the other big station in town. So there was always station rivalry as far as getting listeners.
And they wouldn't work together, they just fought at each other. Stupid, I know, but that's how they were. The one station that supported Slipknot doesn't even really do stuff like that anymore. And the radio station that supported the other band, well, the other band, nothing.
103.3 would not play Slipknot, would not have anything to do with them. And there were a couple people at the station that had actually tried to get them on the air on the local licks program that they had. Well, since Corey Brown ran local licks, he didn't want to have anything to do with it. So there was even more rivalry there because of that. And I guess Corey Brown came out after work one night and found this mutilated chicken on the hood of his car and never really found out who exactly it was that did it, even though everybody knew who did it.
1997, I took a road trip with one of my friends from Lincoln. We were going to Des Moines to the Safari Club to see Nashville Pussy and the Humpers play. and there was another band the night before, or the next day, that I wanted to see. I think it was the Super Suckers. I can't remember. It was a little bit of a Fear and Loathing in Des Moines sort of trip, so there were lots of things I don't fully remember. Sitting at the bar the next day, I met this big burly guy, blonde hair, beard, and he's like, yeah, I own this bar. I'm like, oh, cool, well, I put out records. And he's like, I've got a band, you ought to hear my record. So he hands me a copy of a CD sometime that day, and it was Slipknot's Mate, Feed, Kill, Repeat. So I called Sean and I told him that I really liked what I had heard and I was interested in talking to him more about it. His manager at the time was a lady named Sophia John, or not his, the band's manager. Sophia John is from Lincoln, Nebraska. This all ties back to the Lincoln-Des Moines axis. Sean and Sophia came over to my apartment and we had a discussion and it was decided that I would distribute Slipknot's records, the remaining copies that were available. At this point, Slipknot had not really played outside of Des Moines. Maybe a few shows, but they were all in Iowa.
I had heard the Mate, Feed, Kill, Repeat, which that was not a very good representation of what it ended up. You could see the growth and what it finally became.
The song on there, Do Nothing Bitch Slap, was one of the early songs that really kind of, it was like that metal jazz fusion.
The songs are slower. The couple songs, I think there's like three of them that they redid, new lyrics and a lot faster for you. Self-titled album.
Nobody else was doing that here in Des Moines.
This was right before they played the big show for the Laser in the airfield in Des Moines. So I had these CDs. I sent some to my distributor. Slipknot played the show. The distributor got a lot of orders from the Best Buys in the area from it. And that's where things really started to take off. I think that once the barcode was in the Best Buy computers and it started to register that it was moving a lot of copies, it started to bring some attention to the band. Oh, Sean never ever wanted there to be more than 1,000 copies of that.
Ooh, those guys worked hard. They were darn serious. A lot of thought went into it.
That vision and the intensity of their vision and the seriousness with which they took was there from the beginning.
You could see their photos, images that were published were professionally done. I noticed interviews, answers they had to questions that were given them that were published were more polished, thought out. It was a machine.
And nobody else was putting on electrical tape, wrapping their heads in electrical tape. Nobody else was showering the audience with sparks in quite the same sinister, theatrical way. I mean, many of them were Kiss fans to begin with, and so obviously Slipknot belongs to that whole lineage of Alice Cooper, Kiss, what have you. But these guys were obviously putting the death metal spin on it as Slayer fans, as you know, Norwegian metal fans, what have you. And so that right from the beginning, that was there.
I mean, watched it backstage once. Somebody was supposed to handle something, some sort of stage manager, a prop handler or something like that, did something wrong at this big old festival I was at. And he was getting his butt chewed. He was getting rid. And they frankly, they fined him. They said, "You're fined $50." Part of me's going, "What a bunch of jerks!" But the other part of me's going, "They're serious about attaining what they want to attain here."
Attention! This is 8-1-6.
Brandon Darner was the guy too. And I don't know if you know Sean, Slipknot. Sean has had a side project now called To My Surprise. Brandon's in the band. This is the guy they were yelling at. Just. Strangely enough.
We are Slipknot.
They kind of honed their sound in the clubs, you know, like this one, and doing some regional touring. They would go to Omaha, Nebraska, and other surrounding cities. They got some key radio support, you know, from the local stations. They not only brought Corey Taylor on board, but Sid Wilson, you know, who was a member of a local DJ collective, and so that was another way to kind of enhance their lineup.
They were playing at a Dot Fest. It was a radio station festival, radio festival, whatever. And they were playing in a tent, and that's where they had seen Sid, and that's how Sid became part of Slipknot. he'd always, you know, he was running around saying, you know, I'm going to be famous one day, you know, people were always telling him he'd be famous, and so, I mean, it wasn't a surprise, you know, when he became part of Slipknot.
And so it was a process of kind of like solidifying as a band, finding that sound, you know, bringing these elements, the singer and the DJ.
We didn't really know much about it. I mean, he just, you know, he had been talking that he was in this band and they were practicing all the time and coming over to his house and practicing. And, you know, I got to go to band practice, you know. And it was about 3 or 4 months and we had heard about them getting signed to Roadrunner.
In that short amount of time, there was a lot of change. You know, Anders had quit being the singer of the band. Corey was brought in to sing. There was, you know, Josh had left before the album came out. The Slipknot self-titled album came out. There were like 2 or 3 alternate second drummers that had been gone through. There was a lot of change in the band. They also, you know, quit dealing with me and they quit dealing with Sophia. There was a lot of changeover and turmoil in that point of their career.
A recap. Donny, Josh and Anders have now left. Craig joins to play keyboards and to sample. Cuddles has come and gone, and Mick has come and stayed. Corey has been poached from Stone Sour. Chris has replaced Anders and Jim Josh after Slipknot has signed. So creativity is coming from 0 to 8, from 9 sources.
They pushed envelopes when it came to the vocal. Lyrics were very hard-edged. I mean, like, people equal as shit, very public about that. It was on everything. They were kind of, that was a lot of years ago, and it wasn't as nice to say shit so publicly.
They used the barcode off of Mate, Feed, Kill, Repeat initially. But, you know, it's just a generic identity. And the numbering thing was just because they didn't want to have all these silly, long names for themselves, which is what they had originally.
To make everybody a number? I mean, it's brilliant. I'm not going to remember Corey's name, but I'll remember 8. You know, brilliant. And it's simple. And you suppose they thought about that a lot, or they had a bunch of Jägermeister and they said, everybody pick a number, we're going to be numbers from here on out. And by the way, that's a really cool looking jumpsuit, so we're all going to wear those. I don't know how they decided on this stuff, but probably well thought out. Somebody's a genius.
But it kind of pisses me off. It figures I had the band I've tattooed the most wears fucking coveralls from their knees to their ankles. Fuckers.
Maybe the seeds of the Slipknot stage show were planted more than 20 years ago in Des Moines by the Prince of Darkness. Steve's friend watched Ozzy at that gig.
He threw the bat up on stage. He had no idea Ozzy was going to bite the head off of it. And that's the story he has, and he's sticking to it.
That's right. That was right here. Yeah, that was 1982. Yeah, 1982. And just about 20 years after that, Ozzy came back to play another show at the same venue. But anyway, so yeah, you're right. I mean, so you can bring the theatrical roots of rock and roll and metal right here to the backyard of where Slipknot was born, and so maybe that was inculcated early on, and not just in the music, but in the atmosphere. I don't know.
They played at Harry Mary's as their inaugural We Just Got Signed show, which was, Harry Mary's has never had a turnout like that before.
The last show they did at the Safari before they went on Ozfest after they first got signed, they weren't going to have an opening band. They were just going to play their set and get out, you know, that'd be it. And somebody brought up, I think it was either Mick or Sean brought up us, and everybody's like, okay. Yeah, you can see that. And so we did that show. We opened up for him.
Roadrunner came looking for them. You know, and at this point, they still hadn't played outside of Iowa a lot. It was actually pretty amazing how it went from, like, this band that you never figure out how they're going to go anywhere, and then all of a sudden there's all this interest and they've signed a deal. And then Ross Robinson's going to be producing it. I mean, it was all pretty fast.
We're a band that likes to beat each other up and puke on ourselves.